We're pretty excited that you're tuning in, and we're starting to see more and more folks taking an interest in behavior analysis. It's giving us more and more fuel to keep creating content. So we're very grateful for you tuning in. Today, we're gonna go over a topic that behavior analysis can influence and help, which is one of the most serious challenges that the United States is facing right now. So during the pandemic, so many folks, including myself, we ended up using more and more technology, online technology, more with our phones, and more with internet, and more with communication. And as a result of that, that's opened up the door for major concerns, which is the biggest concern right now is that the United States and other countries are under attack for our infrastructure. And you might remember a year and a half ago or so when the Colonial Pipeline was shut down. So that was done and that ended up shutting down gasoline from all the way from New Jersey down to Florida. So you can imagine the gravity of these things. So here, you know, what we talk about is our behavior science ways to intervene on these types of things. So I want to be clear, I'm not a cybersecurity expert. I'm just a behavior analyst, a board certified behavior analyst that studies human behavior and figures out ways to mobilize people both individually and in groups. And the focus of today are going to be ways that we can handle this major threat to our country and to our individuality and our own personal privacy. The research is showing that between 2021 and 2025, we're looking at an excess of $206 billion in losses by fraud. The dollar amount is less concerning than it is the infrastructure and things that could be shut down. It's such an important issue that back in October of 2021, you may notice that the Attorney General of the United States announced the gravity of this problem. So one of the concerns is that some of these hacks into our privacy not only impact our privacy, but they impact our children, they impact our national security from a military standpoint. And as behavior analysts, what we're doing today is listing the top 13 interventions or behavioral interventions to impact this in a positive way and decrease the likelihood of cyber threats and cyber attacks for you both personally and your organization. So number one, and one of the most important, do not click on links by unknown senders by email. Because when you click on that link, it opens a whole series of potential challenges. A lot of people may not have IT support, but what we'll do is we'll put in the description setting a place where you can report this and they'll attempt to take swift response.
Brett, do you have a go-to security system for your computer that you believe is a good firewall in terms of just to have something to set up initially just to protect yourself rather than having to go through an IT person? At least you have that to protect yourself.
Yes, absolutely. So again, me not being an expert, I'm just trying to follow the expert guidelines, and I'm sure there are many other people that are better at keeping their phone and their laptop secure. But for me, I use a VPN, such as NordVPN, and that also prevents the recipient of the information from knowing exactly where you're browsing and your location. And then the second thing is I use LifeLock. So LifeLock is excellent in terms of freezing your credit immediately and being able to identify dark web activity that may have your name or your social security number in it. That's a good question. Number two, I'll put in the link below, there are organizations, some of them may do it free, that'll provide for you and your organization what's called penetration testing. These are ethical penetration tests where they look at the vulnerabilities within your organization's IT systems, including your own personal devices. So that's a really big one. We'll put that in the link below. Number three, make sure that you disable Bluetooth when you're not using it. Because believe it or not, Bluetooth is a way that these malicious actors sometimes can get into your cell phone and get access to information that could be used. Number four, this is an important one. Do not connect to public Wi-Fi networks, especially places like airports, which are valuable targets for those malicious actors. So you're better off using your hotspot, if you can, as your Wi-Fi. And make sure that you also delete previous Wi-Fi networks that may automatically connect. Because Wi-Fi, it's an area that presents a strong vulnerability when it's not your personal Wi-Fi. The public Wi-Fis are big concerns. Number five, this one's an interesting one. There are people that will be able to hack into your phone and listen on your microphone. So it's important to use, there are protective cases out there that drown out the sound of like any conversation you may be having. So that's another one. I'll put a link in the description below for that. I don't have that yet, but I want it.
Is that an application that you download for your phone?
No, it's actually a physical case.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and I don't know how it does it, but that's pretty cool, you know? Number six, and this is something we practice quite often in our very sensitive meetings. Do not have your mobile phone within close proximity of you when you're having a very sensitive meeting. So if you remember, we were having those meetings in my backyard where we had a segregated Wi-Fi, we had high-level security, and there were times that we had really important conversations where all of our cell phones were put pretty far from our... And what you can do is put on a special notification if you're concerned about your children needing to contact you. And number seven for your mobile phone and for your computer, you want to make sure that you're using biometrics or facial recognition. So biometrics, one of the best things you can do is make sure you have a fingerprint to unlock your phone. And if you can have that on your laptop, that's helpful too. Okay, number eight behavior hack to handle cybersecurity vulnerabilities would be make sure that anytime you get the notification on your mobile phone that there's an update, you want to make sure that you do that immediately, even though it can be time consuming and you know that you can't receive texts at the moment and it downloads it. And you want to make sure that when that software update for your phone is available, that you immediately do that. Because what happens is typically it's been identified as a vulnerability and Google really rapidly responds and they'll provide you with the update. So when you're on your laptop or on a PC, look in the upper right-hand corner if you use Google or Google Chrome. You'll see where it'll say update and you want to try to do that immediately and then it restarts, reboots. It provides what they call patches and the patches prevent you from being compromised.
So. I think that's a great piece of advice because a lot of people I know actually put their updates on hold and they'll just keep
yeah.
on hold tomorrow, 3 hours from now, 5 hours from now, because not only does it cause that inconvenience, like you were saying, you don't get your messages and it takes a few minutes, sometimes it takes an hour, but then your phone gets moved around a little bit, like the updates, they don't like the way their phone looks. So it's good to know on the back end perspective why it's good to do that update immediately.
Exactly, because it is a kind of a pain in the ass, but knowing the gravity of it kind of lets you know that you want to do it immediately. Number nine, and there are apps that can help you with this, but what you want to do is take the extra time to make sure that you close all the apps that you're not using. So by having too many apps open, that presents the opportunity for more breaches. The other thing is that if you're not using apps regularly, the US government recommends that you uninstall those apps and then just reinstall them later. And when it comes to these applications, most phones also will allow you to manually click, instead of just hitting accept once, that you're going to allow the app to access your camera, your microphone, and your files. It's important to set it up, even though it takes longer and it's more response effort, you want to set up your phone so that every time you open the app, it's manually, you're clicking that you're accepting the microphone, you're accepting the file access, and those sorts of things. Even though it takes longer, it'll keep you safer. Number 10, recommended by the US government, is also that you use original charging cords that are from the manufacturer of the device, and that when you're in an airport, and more you'll see these places where you can access free electricity to charge your phone. At all costs, you don't want to plug in those USBs in those devices because they're often compromised.
So we've went over a couple antecedent interventions, right? Bringing extra batteries to charge your phone and laptop, installing that malware device on the computer as an antecedent intervention. Another thing that we did go over is putting those camera covers over your camera and your laptops to make sure that when you're not using them, your information can't be compromised. And the last thing is uninstalling apps that you're no longer using or don't use as often anymore.
Yes. Number 11 is if you're going somewhere that you would imagine is sensitive, I don't exactly know what that would be, but what you want to do is turn off your location services. So if you're not using Google Maps or some kind of location GPS, make sure you turn that off, because there are ways that the hackers can get in to find out where you are. So sometimes for your own safety, you may want to turn off the location access. And number 12, it's recommended that at least once a week that you power off your device and then start it again, because quite too often, without even realizing it, you might click on something and accept it. And I'll tell you what drives me crazy with an Android device. I don't know if you Android users get frustrated with this. Can you comment down and below? Because they have Bixby, and Bixby is very difficult to remove from your device, and it automatically comes on when you engage in certain activities. Even when you've tried to disable it, it comes on anyway. So if you guys could comment that, if you're an Android user, can you comment if you have certain hacks for that? Because we haven't quite figured that out. Now, number 13, this applies a little bit more to the Android users as well. Never jailbreak your phone or root your phone. I'm not sure if I've never done this, but the guidance is that there are times that people do this so that way they can have full control over their phone. That way they can use apps that are not in the approved app stores, such as iOS and Android. So when you do that, you really open up your device to just about anyone to be able to access your information, because they aren't approved apps that have been vetted. The purpose of this video isn't to incite fear and to scare the public. It's just ways that you're going to feel safer and secure with your money and your privacy. And you know, something we often talk a lot about in leadership is that the safer you feel, the more you can be courageous and engage in ways and behaviors to help people. Because if you don't feel safe, I know for myself, if I don't feel safe, it's really hard for me to provide service to others when I'm worried about my own financial or physical safety.